Okay, very much welcome to the lecture on action and cognition. I start with a few announcements. One is there's a talk by Bill Phillips tomorrow. He's from professor at the University of Stirling, and he will talk about specialization and coordination of probabilistic inference in neural systems. So this relates to the Bayesian stories that the brain is essentially a big Bayesian machine, and he has done important work early on coherent informax. And the talk will be tomorrow 4 p.m. sharp here in this building. And Wednesday we have another talk by Dana Ballard. He has written the book Natural Computation and done a lot of work on predictive coding, which is essentially the same Bayesian story, slightly different viewpoint. And he will take a new look at human motor control. He's presently at the University of, well, presently he's in a research group in Bielefeld, and he will visit us on Wednesday. Okay, then last week I cut short the lecture slightly while I was rambling on how to define cortical areas. So we discussed a little bit cytoarchitectonics. So essentially you cut the cortex into slices. You stain, for example, with NISSL or your favorite staining, and you look at the distribution of cell bodies, somata, across a radial extent of the cortex, and you find the same six layers everywhere, but there are quantitative differences. And way back, Kobian Protman has tessellated the human brain, actually the left brain of one individual, into 52 different cortical areas based on the cytoarchitectonics. And for example, it is rather marked in primary visual cortex and primary motor cortex. You can define an area based on the anatomical connectivity. So for example, area MT, we will talk about this at length in a few weeks' time, receive a specific type of projection, and you can look, okay, which fraction of the cortex has these afferents, and you can delineate area MT. Today we will also talk a lot about topographic maps, and with the example of primary visual cortex, but essentially you find topographic maps everywhere in the brain, besides the hippocampus, but there are maps all over the place. In primary visual cortex you have a topographic map of visual space, which essentially means that neighboring points in visual space trigger activity at neighboring points in primary visual cortex. And the whole visual extent is mapped to the primary visual cortex. It's a distorted map. So like you cut out a globe and you try to have it flat, some parts are magnified, other parts are distorted, and so on. But it can very well define a cortical area because it contains one complete map. So that's another way to define a cortical area. Cellular response properties. So for example, in infratemporal cortex, this will be early new year, just after Christmas, you find phase selective and object selective neurons. And you can delineate a whole area where you find such cellular response properties, and you call it area infratemporal cortex. Or in parietal cortex, there's a similar scheme in LIP, VIP, and so on. Areas we will discuss as well. So neighboring neurons respond to the same type of stuff, like for example faces, objects, when you make circuits, and so on. You have regional response properties. So sometimes you have neurons, well, in human cortex, you find areas which light up using fMRI, for example when you present a face. And you suspect that the neurons are phase selective as well. Only in humans, that's hard to show. It's much easier in monkey. And in monkeys, the detailed organization is a little bit different, but they are actually phase selective patches. And in humans, the area, which is in the fusiform phase area, so in the fusiform cortex, is called an area because the whole extent responds differentially somehow to the presentation of a visual phase. Or you take cross anatomy. This is, for example, anterior, central, or posterior inferotemporal cortex. It's a little bit like let's say, Africa. You have East and West Africa. Well, you have also North and Middle and South Africa. So some people think Africa is so large, it has to be divided. And infrarotemporal cortex is pretty large, so we just divided it somehow, without any specific reason or any primary argument where exactly the boundary should be. So if you argue, okay, West and East Africa, sure, on the coasts it's easy, but where you draw the boundary in the center is actually a difficult question. So these are all different ways to define an area. Sometimes we are lucky. So for example, the cytoarchitectonics defining primary visual cortex, and the topographic map defining primary visual cortex, and to some extent the cellular response properties, we will discuss today, orientation, selectivity and the like, all give you the same area. That's wonderful. You have different ways to define an area and they all match. The list of such positive examples is short. You will quickly come to know areas where we have an incompatible definition based on cytoarchitectonics and, for example, cellular response properties. Famous example is Broca's area. It's a motoric language area. If you have a lesion, you have problems to produce linguistic structures. However, the cytoarchitectonics comprise area 44 and area 45, but not completely. So it's an incongruent tessellation of cortex, and I could make more examples. So the different parts not always give identical definitions. Yes, please. Good point. Essentially, it would be regional response properties, which you show by means of a lesion. I admit a lesion is not the same as showing activity when you use it. I would be willing to argue another point here. Okay, where was I? So that sometimes the ways to define an area are incongruent, and actually researchers do their own contribution to make it a mess. So for example, in the summer term we will talk about mirror neurons. These mirror neurons are active when you see somebody else doing a specific action, for example, picking a raisin, and they are active when you yourself do that action. This is, of course, fascinating. And Rizzolatti in Italy has discovered these and termed the area, which is somewhere in the frontal lobe, F5. Okay, it sticks with it. So it's his personal definition, so to say, how to tessellate the frontal lobe. And insofar, it's not that easy to do these experiments, and there are a few labs. And sometimes the lab internal terminology finds its way to the literature and you have yet another definition. Because this area F5 comprises, of course, different parts of Brodmann area 4, Brodmann area 6, and maybe even a little bit of Brodmann area 8. So you see, it's pretty messy, and we have to discuss in individual cases which the best way to define an area and which terminology we use. For today, we are lucky. Primary visual cortex, the topic of today, is pretty much the cytoarchitectonics, topographic maps, cellular response properties. And if you want, actually the anatomical connectivity from the retina via the lateral geniculate nucleus also defines primary visual cortex reasonably well. Okay, with that, last week's lecture is at an end. We start for today. Example questions. Question 4, we just discussed, so this is boring. Describes the scaling law of cortex weight and the number of cortical neurons in rodents and primates. When I ask this question in the exam, I would expect that you start writing, okay, in case a brain encompasses more neurons, obviously it has to weigh more. As it happens, In rodents, it's found that it scales with the power law. And the power law is roughly 1.5. So I'm not picky about the numbers, but the important aspect here, the number is larger than 1. Because this shows if you increase the number of cortical neurons, the cortical weight scales faster. And given an arbitrary large brain, at some point, the density of neurons is pretty low. And the scaling law is different in primates. There the exponent is roughly 1. And more specifically, you might add that the human brain as a primate brain follows that scaling law. This would be an easy mid-level question. And you discuss these questions in the tutorials. Yes, Basil? These are, yes. Oh, too bad. Okay. So there's an inconsistency. I will check the questions. So the valid questions, of course, address the contents of the lecture. And maybe the last slide of the last lecture was already referring somewhat to the stuff of today. But we can discuss it. So what I present in the lecture is the valid topic. And if a question is not answered by the preceding lecture, it doesn't pertain to it. Okay, questions so far. Good. I start with the classic experiments. We know a lot about primary visual cortex. In macaque monkey, where it's heavily investigated, primary visual cortex is here at the occipital pole. Here would be the frontal pole, occipital pole, dorsal, ventral. It's a purple-violet area shown here. And actually, in the macaque monkey, it is on a smooth surface. This has simple, very strong practical advantages, because you can look at the cortex in a very literal sense. We will discuss this today when we introduce optical imaging. As well, you can easily stick in electrodes. It is obvious in a human brain, well, first, you don't want to do such experiments with humans. Secondly, primary visual cortex is deep in here. You hardly see anything of primary visual cortex because it's hidden in the calcarine fissure. Much less accessible. So for optical imaging, you wouldn't be able to do experiments here. And another practical advantage with vision is you can make it dark easily. Sounds trivial, but to make it soundproof is much more expensive. And in so far, making visual experiments is much, much easier than to make auditory experiments. And as an upshot, we know much more about primary visual cortex than any other area in the cortical, in the brain. And we specifically know much more than in auditory cortex. And only in recent years, the other modalities are catching up. But still, primary visual cortex is leading. And much of the research is demonstrating that similar stuff holds in the other cortices as well. Slight overstatement, but not too much. Okay, here you see many other areas. And the question is, on one hand, where is primary visual cortex in the brain? But also, where is it in the circuit diagram? So how is it wired up with other areas? And this circuit diagram looks frightening at first. Stay cool, you will love it at the end of the term. Here we have the retina. We have the lateral geniculate nucleus. Today we talk about primary visual cortex. Here. This is the secondary visual cortex. And next week we will introduce already a division here in the dorsal pathway and the ventral pathway. So to say left and right in this diagram. We will work our way up, and here are areas which I mentioned before, area MT or inferotemporal cortex, and here are areas of the frontal lobe. So the circuit diagram puts down all the areas we know in the macaque monkey. Next is, it connects it with lines where we know these areas are connected, a little bit like a subway map. Finally, it puts it up in a hierarchy. And there is a neat story to it. that the connections, for example, between primary visual cortex and secondary visual cortex are asymmetric. And if these are of one type, and secondary visual cortex, for example, with area V4 are again the same asymmetry, then we can make a pretty good prediction that V1 to V4 will be of the same type. So in some sense, there are no circles in here. We can present all the areas in a hierarchical fashion, clearly stating which are higher and which are lower. And therefore, these diagrams are, so to say, important. Not the details, but the overall spirit. And this will be a major topic next week. So, here we have primary visual cortex. It is just one box in this diagram. From the cortical surface, it's a huge chunk. You see it here in blue in the macaque monkey. And many other areas are really tiny in comparison. So we are talking a good fraction of all the neurons. And compared our knowledge, so if we would draw a homunculus where each area is plotted, according to our knowledge, V1 would be huge, and some other areas you would hardly see. Classical experiments, and I must say, much of the stuff I present here is taken from animal experiments. That's a story for itself, but there's no mistake. If we are interested in the cellular mechanism, so how neurons talk to each other and so on, animal experiments are the leading source of our knowledge. With fMRI, EEG, all the non-invasive methods which can be used with humans, essentially we can look, okay, where is activity in a specific situation? But it's hard to understand, based on these methods, the why and the how. So, for example, I will tell you, well, there's a specific region in the brain which is active when you view a face. That's interesting. But does it really help? Well, I knew before there is neuronal activity in my brain if I look at your face. Of course, somehow, I have the perception of the face, something must happen in my brain. And that these neurons are organized in a patch which I call an area is not that surprising. And that it's located in the fusiform gyrus, okay, it's nice to know, but where to go from here? And this is a big difference. And so far, I will try to strike the balance here in my presentation, what I present based on human work and what is presented from animal work. These specific experiments are now 61, 50 years old. And they earned Hubel and Wiese Nobel Prize. And essentially, they demonstrated, or at that time it was known, that neurons in the retina react to points of light on dark background, or the opposite. And neurons in the lateral geniculate nucleus, the next relay station, have very similar behavior. And nothing much was known about the primary visual cortex. And a number of labs investigated with dots of light in order to try activate primary visual cortex. And they found out that if you present not points, but extended contours, so a qualitatively different stimulus, you can reliably activate neurons in primary visual cortex. This is shown in this cartoon. These are different example stimuli from horizontal to oblique to vertical orientation and back again. And here each vertical line denotes an action potential. And you see that example neuron would be optimally activated by a vertical light bar, a little bit by a slightly oblique light bar, and not at all by a horizontal one. And this is a typical example. Orientation sensitivity is the hallmark of primary visual cortex. Virtually all cells in primary visual cortex are selective to orientation to a certain degree. And if in an experiment you cannot reproduce that, chances are you have not made an earth-shaking discovery, but your experiment is buggy. So that's the status of that finding. Let's look a little bit more in detail. They are so-called simple cells. Simple cells are here used as a technical term, because those two guys considered them simple. Okay. we have our example stimuli, and in this example, it's a nearly horizontal oriented contour which elicits a response. That this is shown in yellow should indicate it's a bright stimulus on a dark background. These two stimuli are dark on a light background. And you see, if you go through it, changing the orientation has a systematic variation in activity. That's the optimum. If we invert the contrast and go to this one, the response goes away. So the neuron is selective to the contrast polarity of the stimulus. If we move this dark bar a little bit up, then suddenly we have a response again. You can understand this scheme by the following model. You take a receptive field of an LGN cell. So this receptive field would not be the one of the simple cell in the cerebral cortex, but one step before, at the lateral chitinic nucleus. You have an on-center, off-the-round construction. That neuron would be active when you have a bright spot in the center on a dark surround. Now you take several of these, slightly shifted in space, and hook them up. The result is an elongated sensitive field, excitatory or on zone, and satellite off zones. Let's go through it. If we have our optimal stimulus, slightly oblique here right on the center, sure enough, we get a huge response. If we change the orientation, more and more of the stimulus wanders off the excitatory region, the on region, onto the satellite inhibitory bands. And plus and minus cancels each other, and we have less and less response. If you put the dark bar on the center, well, nothing much happens. Of course not. It's dark, no light, on a light-sensitive region. This doesn't work. We don't have a response. And if you move it up, we have the dark bar on the inhibitory flank, so we have no excitation of the inhibitory flank, which is the D-inhibition, which leads to a response. So a bright bar on the center works, a dark bar on the satellite works as well. And so far we can understand the whole response properties here based on that little simple receptive field like. I will use the term receptive field extensively. I'm not such a big fan of it, but there's no way around here, which means denotes the region in visual space a neuron is responsive to. So you have to do something in visual space at the location of the receptive field in order to activate the neuron. And here with the simple cell, it's easy enough. You need an oriented contour at the correct position and the correct orientation. And I emphasize this correct, double correct, correct orientation and correct position, because both conditions have to be fulfilled in order to activate the neuron. This is, so to say, simple. And in primary visual cortex, roughly 50% of all neurons are simple cells. Yes, please. Let's say we work with an equiluminant gray background. And we just add, take away light here, and everything else would be gray. Then you have a response. If you make everything else bright, it would actually still work, because you have no inhibition here, you have a stronger excitation here, you have some inhibition here, which prevails because the inhibition here is missing. So essentially, yes. Okay? So lighter than the stimulus itself. Okay, so you don't need to have absolute darkness. This could be the no contrast is perfect, that it's really absolute dark. And so far we are just discussing that this region here is darker than all the surround. And typically these experiments are done at high contrast, but not perfect. So high contrast, I mean 1 to 10 or 1 to 100. Pressure monitors are even better, but this is not necessary. Okay? Good, so when this neuron is active, I, so to say, know a lot. Essentially, I know there is some stimulus here which matches the receptive field to a certain degree, either bright bar here or dark bar here. So if they are simple cells, they must be complex cells. And they work this way. We have different orientations of bright stimuli again. I've selected the same optimal orientation for a response. So far, no difference. The difference comes in here when we invert the contrast. When we invert the contrast of the central black bar, central bar, we still have a response. And if we move it up, we again have a response. This is a major difference here. So we could explain it by the superposition of two different simple cells. One with an on center and off the round, and the second one with an off center and on the round. Superimposed and added up. So for this stimulus, the first simple cell would be strongly active, the other one would be not active, but there is no negative activity. Adding these two activities, zero plus a lot, gives a medium amount of activity. For this bar, the first one would be silent, the second one would be highly active, averaging gives again a medium amount of activity, and the same here. So the complex cell has the response properties like two simple cells with opposite polarity added up. And each simple cell makes, so to say, an absolute value of its activity. Because there are no negative activities, they cannot cancel each other. The complex cells make up roughly the remaining half of neurons in primary visual cortex. And no surprise, people think to a certain degree they are, so to say, subsequent to the simple cells. So also the layering, we come to this in a moment. The simple cells are numerous in layer 4 and layer 6. And layer 4 is a recipient layer where all the terminals, or where the afferents from the lateral chain nucleate nucleus end. And complex cells are pretty much abundant above and below. Insofar, it is, so to say, natural to assume that the visual signal is first processed by the simple cells and then the complex cells. Yes, please? Yes. Good question. Very good question. I like to point out, if I tell you the activity of the simple cell, you have a pretty good idea of the stimulus. If I tell you the activity of the complex cell, you know less. That's puzzling. It's, in spite of the additional processing, essentially you have less information, which is good. I think it's most important to discard information, all the variability, because if I describe what I'm seeing right now, this is enormous. So a reasonably sized JPEG image would have kilobytes of information. Yet what's important, you are here. Yeah, well, that's it. So whether the light comes from the left or the right, on a pixel level, the image would look very, very different. But this is not relevant for me. So to discard information which is not relevant. Like, for example, the polarity of the contrast here is an important step. In that sense, complex neurons are throwing away some type of information and are generating an invariance. So their response strength is not dependent on a specific aspect. And so for not only the specificities and selectivities which we will discuss, but also the invariance operations are very important. Okay, and I might say at the end we have face recognition, object recognition, and so on. And face recognition or object recognition means that I can identify a specific face or object independent of lighting, positioning, viewpoint, distance, and all that stuff. So not only the selectivity, but also the invariance operation is fundamental for the purpose of the visual system and sensory systems in general. However, I would like to show how this appears